Okay, thank you, Remedios, to invite me in this conference, and would like to thank all the members of the committees. And it's a pleasure for me to share with you the knowledge about the raw milk microbiota and farm practices for the preservation of the microbial biodiversity of raw milk. So raw milk microbiota is an important part of the many traditional cheeses. And to maintain a high taxonomic diversity in indigenous microbial communities, you must understand some key factors for the farm practices. So there are different sources of microorganism, of reservoir of microorganism milk. In my first presentation, I will just talk about lactic bacteria, but the raw milk microbiota is very, very diverse, and I think it could be better to speak about the others too. So my presentation is about the farm practices that have an influence on the composition of raw milk. So the milk microbiota is very diverse. We can find different kinds of microorganisms. Lactic bacteria and other ripening bacteria, and we have about 60-65 species about this kind of bacteria. We have so gram-negative bacteria and ripening bacteria, yeast and molds, and we have about 300 species of bacteria and 74 species of yeast in the repertory in milk. So microbiota is each farm has its own microbial balance and diversity. Here is just a focus on the balance of microbial groups you can show here from four different farms. So we'll see different profiles of different groups of microorganisms. So this balance differs from farms and could be very stable in each farm. But the diversity is equally on the diversity on strength specific diversity of lactic acid bacteria, and as we shown here, this is phylogenetic tree from fragment of DNA of different kind of Lactococcus lactis bacteria, and when the branch and leaves are close together, it means that the strengths are similar genetically. Strengths in surrounding green are from raw goat milk, and those strains are close to environmental samples, so probably source of animal feed, grass from pasture and beans. This kind of genetic closed DNA could suppose that the origin of some lactic acid bacteria are from farm environment and vegetables grass. Okay, so the problem is this bacteria, this Lactococcus lactis bacteria, is very interesting on different points, technological points, acidification, of course, aroma compounds, but equally on healthy interest of this trend. But the problem is that these 10 years, next last 10 years, we have decrease of this kind of bacteria, so it could be very difficult to find this bacteria in farm environment. So we have to check the links between farm practices, drastic hygienic practices, and this kind of bacteria. And some authors suppose that there is a publication about the use of pesticide and the link between the use of pesticides and the impact on this kind of bacteria. So it's generally agreed that the season has a great impact on the balance and nature of microorganisms. Probably because in season we include different change, lactation, animal feed and environment during the making, etc. The first picture illustrates the balance between groups of microorganisms in two seasons for one farm, and it's an example of a milk from a cheese cooperative in the Cantal. In summer, the milking is done in the grazing as area, and in winter, indoor. Scientists note that the most abundant microorganism in outdoor in May, in season of May, we have lots of bacteria, high frequencies of bacteria associated to the soil bacteria, as Pseudomonas, Acinetobacter, Lactococcus, and other species. And in indoor system, in February, we have most of outgut-associated bacteria. So we have a closely linked between bacteria in environment and milk. In goat, we have the same result, and we have some difference between a season, and as we show, there is difference between winter, autumn, and summer. And we notice that Lactococcus lactis, which is lactic acid bacteria, is more frequent in winter season, probably because close to the litter, the bedding, and this kind of sources. So let's see now the microbial transfer from environmental sources and raw milk. It's generally agreed, and Céline showed us, that the teat is a main reservoir of microorganisms, but not only the teat. We have hair and a milking machine, which is a milking machine is rather a carrier of different source and specific habitat for some bacteria. And it's main sources of acid lactic bacteria because of the presence of milk residue. And we know that this kind of bacteria aim to develop, to grow in lactose and protein matter. In Ireland, in a research farm, Doyle followed different kind of species of bacteria from different sources, and it's in one farm, and we can see in this figure that bacteria from teat, feces, and grass could be a major source of bacteria of milk. You see teat in orange color. And we see that teat, we have the representation of the proportion of each sources in milk. So we see that teat is very important. And we see too that the seasonal housing influence the microbiota of the milk. Indoor and outdoor, it's different. You have more different kinds of bacteria in outdoor system, for example. What's the teat reservoir, its composition, and the practice that influence it? So we have we just speak about the flow of microorganisms, tit skin from milk and cheese. This is a study made by Fritten, Marie Fritten, and we saw just the first figure is the proportion of different kinds of phylum of bacteria. And so we see that, for example, in tit skin, we have approximately 50% of bacteria in tit skin are firmicutes. It means Staphylococcus, Lactobacillus, lactic acid bacteria, and Clostridia, for example. And we see that in cheese, it's the most important core in cheese. And for example, we have Actinobacteria, approximately 40% Actinobacteria. In Actinobacteria, we have bacteria involved in the ripening of cheese, and we see that we have the same, approximately the same proportion in milk, but in cheese it's different because we have a decrease of this kind of bacteria. If you compare different studies, we have two studies in cow milk. In teat, we compare the different species in the teat of cow. And we see that the most important species, which is the same in teat and milk and cheese, is lactic acid bacteria, Lactobacillus. And we have two Staphylococcus and other species. But with the two or three studies, we see that Lactobacillus are present in teat and in milk and the same species. In goat milk, we have approximately the same result. The most important bacteria is gram-positive coagulase-positive bacteria, is Staphylococcus and some other Corynebacteria. And we have lactic acid bacteria has Enterococcus, Lactobacillus, and Lactococcus lactis, Leuconostoc, and Pediococcus. And we show that there is a link between this kind of bacteria and the milk. So coated, coated skin and goat skin serve a potential source of microorganisms found in milk and in raw milk cheeses, and teat could be a source of lactic acid bacteria and non-sorted lactic bacteria and other bacteria involved in the ripening of cheese. And other studies show, for example, that there is a correlation between the bedding and the composition of teat, and there is a good correlation between bacteria involved in the ripening of cheeses. Other authors show that Lactobacillus plantarum and Paraplantarum could be present in grass, hay, and floor, and could be the same profile of genetic traits feature in the bedding, in teat, and in milk. So we demonstrate the flow of such microorganisms through the bedding and from the milk. What about the practices? It's difficult to answer really of a good common answer about practices. We know that season is very important because it's a combination of different kind of practices. So, for example, we know that in winter we have more some groups of microorganisms, lactic acid bacteria and halophilic microorganisms, for example. The bedding is very important, and the nature of bedding. Different authors show that, for example, we have higher level in sawdust, straw, than in rubber mat. The density is very important too, For example, Wooten, this scientist showed that we have lots of more lactobacilli in teed up barns than in freeze-thawed barns. The soil bedding is very important. If the bedding is soil, we can have more enterococci. And what is important too is the milking practices. So the pre-dipping show that in pre-dipping we have a reduction of level and a considerable reduction of gram-negative bacteria. And some recent studies show that we have higher level of bacteria in wooden wool than in pre-dipping practices. And in pre-dipping, we have lower frequencies of some good, interesting bacteria as Lactococcus lactis, for example. So let's, and for the milking machine, what its composition and the practice that influence it. The milking machine is rather a carrier of different sources of bacteria, and it's a specific habitat for some bacteria, has lactic acid bacteria, because of the presence of milk and residue in the milking machine, even after cleaning. And in the milking machine, we have biofilm, which is a specific organization of microorganisms. They stick and clump together and on the surface of the material by production of polymers. And this kind of organization gives a better resistance to cleaning and disinfecting products. And when the biofilm is mature, some parts of it go outside and go to the milk and then inoculate the milk. Different works have been done about the microorganism that may be mobilized in the milking machine. So there are lots of work in goat milk production. So we see different figures. In the figure, we have different kinds of bacteria. So we see here that the main, there is high quantity of Staphylococcus coagulase negative bacteria in the milking machine, and we have some kinds of spoilage bacteria as Pseudomonas. But if you see the acidification potential of the milking machine by put sericide milk in the milking machine, we have two cinetic of acidification. In blue is the acidification cinetic of raw milk in the milking machine, and in gray we have cinetic acidification of sterilized milk that go in the milking machine. So we see that there is the same acidification profile. So milking machine could be a very good carrier of acidifying bacteria. And we identify bacteria in UHT in sterilized milk, and we see that there are lots of Lactococcus lactis friend, Enterococcus, and heterofermentative facultative Lactobacillus. In cow milk, there are low level in on microorganisms in the milking machine, and different scientists show that there are different kinds of microorganisms, and we have the same level of microorganism of interest in comparison with coliform and pseudomonad. And we have, they show that there are many strains of Lactococcus lactis species. So milk may be inoculated by the milking machine. So we have two kinds of bacteria, major bacteria, Pseudomonas, which could be a spoilage bacteria, and lactic acid bacteria. We have other bacteria, but they are the main bacteria frequently in the milking machine. So we study different studies show the links between design and cleaning practice of milking machine. So they show that what it's important is to have very simple milking machine with a design very simple and no elbows and no high level of pipelines. It's important because if there is a whole level of complexity in the milking machine, we have it's linked to defect of cleaning and a higher level of pseudomonas. And what is important too is the composition of the material in the milking machine, and some studies show when there is a high proportion of stainless and steel glass, the level of microorganism is decreasing. And for example, we compare silicone liners from rubber liners, and in silicone liners we have the level of bacteria is less higher. And about cleaning practices, it's very difficult to have some good practice, but that we know that when the temperature is upper than 60 degrees, we have a decreasing of bacteria. If there is defects in maintenance of the milking machine, we can have a high level of bacteria. And the rotation of alkaline and acid products each day could be a trend to increase of pseudomonas and coliforms. And we have some studies about chlorine use in products, and when there is no chlorine in the products, you have a high level of microorganisms. So for pseudomonas, just focus on pseudomonas because it could be present in the milking machine. So for pseudomonas, it could be very important to have a dry environment, because if we have some water in the milking machine, it could be we can have a growth of pseudomonas and biofilm of pseudomonas. It's very important. And the second thing is the temperature of water in the end of cleaning. We saw that the temperature must be higher than 36 degrees. So to summary, the microbial transfer between the teeth from the milk, you have different kinds of microorganisms in these different reservoirs, different sources. Teeth are a main source of bacteria. In yellow, it's bacteria of ripening enterocyte. So it's main source of this kind of bacteria. In air, we have lots of this kind of bacteria too. And in milking machine, we have a great diversity of bacteria. And in green, we have lactic acid bacteria, which is very important for the cheese making process. So it's finished. Mm-hmm. Okay. I just show something about to summary the preservation of microorganisms, all kind of practices. First, it's important to have grass in the environment of the milk. So in bedding, we prefer have straw or grass, and no separation between bedding and milking parlor to enhance the quantity of bacteria. Practice of teeth are very important too, and it could be more or less extensive. For example, use some wooden rules. For example, it's an example. And in the milking machine, it's important to have a very simple conception, design of this milking machine, and practices of cleaning machine less extensive. It could be very, very important, the temperature and the quantity of product. And it's important to rinse correctly the milking machine because it could be a source of Pseudomonas. And for the milk, the storage of milk had to be not very long because it's so too long, we can't have a growth of Pseudomonas. It's important to just a slide about cheese. Some study show a shift between milk and cheeses because cheeses is very it's very specific because we have different kinds of parameters as pH, temperature, and salt that is parameters select different kinds of bacteria. So the diversity decreases. It's normal because it's cheese making practices, but it's important to preserve some practices like backsloping or use indefinite starters, use some tools like wooden or, for example, for other countries, terracotta, which are improve the preservation because of the formation of biofilm. And it's important to take time to make cheese because the growth of bacteria from milk take time. First is lactic acid bacteria, but ripening bacteria from milk must have time to grow. So ripening is very important. So what's the challenge in the future? So we know that traditional systems are a source of invaluable microbial diversity and crucial for rural and developing countries. So we have to continue to explore these microbial systems and the flow from animal housing to cheese and to maintain some traditional practices. Even more, we have now omic tools that give more information about this microbial diversity and the relationships between this diversity and practices. And what is important that it's together, it's better together, scientists, technologists, and farmers. And it's important to have confrontation of different approach and to have more data, more strong, and to share culture of role. Thank you very much.